And you guys need audio levels? Hey, 1, 2, 1, 2. Check, 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 check. 1, 2, 1, 2. You're good? Got a thumbs up. Got a thumbs up. Hey, hey, hey. 1, 2, 1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2. You're good? Hey, 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 hey. All right, all right.
I've seen on the same bed with the question. The queen is all.
Good morning. I want to thank you for joining me, my colleagues from the Pennsylvania House and the Pennsylvania Senate, as well as advocates for prison reform. Being sentenced to time in prison means a loss of liberty, but not the basic human rights. While convicted criminals must answer for their offenses, we need a correctional system that respects human rights, helps to facilitate safe reentry to society, and when appropriate, allows for alternatives to incarceration. Today you will hear from members who will share their support for several pieces of legislation focused on prison reform. Legislation that will reward probation and parole compliances. Legislation that will help to ensure the nutritional value and better health at our state prison systems. Legislation that creates safer alternatives to arrest for minor offenses. Legislation that provides medical parole for those who are aging and terminally ill. Legislation that will support veterans who are reentering society. And legislation that will support families to stay connected to loved ones who are incarcerated. Before we begin, I'd like to introduce our members and guests who are here on stage with me today. And I'll start to my left. We have Representative Nelson. We have Mr. Andrews from the Prison Society. We have Representative Herron. We have Representative Sanchez. We have our Democratic Whip, Representative Harris. We have Representative Kincaid. We have our Democratic Leader, Leader McClinton. Thank you. We have Representative Patty Kim. We have Representative Young. We have Representative Hohenstein. We have Senator Street. We have Representative Schusterman. We have Chairman Briggs. We also have Representative Parker, Representative Curry, Representative Hill Evans, and Representative Brooks. Again, I want to thank you all for joining me here this morning. You will now hear from our Democratic Whip, Representative Harris, followed by Representative Briggs, who is the Democratic Chairman of the House Judiciary Committee, and then followed by Senator Street, who is the Democratic Chairman of Senate State Government.
Good morning. As Representative Kinsey said, I'm Pennsylvania State Representative Jordan Harris. It is my honor and privilege to serve my colleagues in my caucus as a Democratic Whip. Let me first thank Representative Kinsey for bringing us here together and organizing this and pulling this package together, and thank the collection of colleagues that we have who have put their effort and their work into this. Also to our leader who is here, Representative McClinton, a former public defender and one who definitely has a long breadth of work history in this area. Listen, prison is supposed to be about rehabilitation, okay? We call it the Department of Corrections. Corrections, not the Department of Punishment, but the Department of Corrections. And what you're going to hear today is a collection of pieces of legislation that we believe actually goes to the mission of what the Department of Corrections is supposed to be about. And that's correcting behavior and redirecting folks so that many of those who are our brothers, sisters, and siblings can come back into our society. One of the things that we must be clear on is that a supermajority of people who are in our criminal justice system, who are in our prison system, are coming home to our communities. And if we do not give them the tools to be successful, if we do not give them the skills to be successful, what we are complicit in doing is creating a revolving door to our prison system, to our prison industrial complex. Additionally, what we must make sure that we're doing is that our justice system is actually just. We must make sure that it is actually fair. This is not about us turning a blind eye to crime, but what it is saying is that sentences should equate to what was done and not just sentencing people because we're mad at them. That is not what the Department of Corrections is about. We spend way too much money incarcerating people who are no longer a threat or danger to society. Way too much money, where we should be investing those resources in other things. So what you're going to hear today is about a credit for parole and probation, an issue that I've worked on and look forward to moving forward on. We're going to be hearing about medical release. We have folks in our system who are aging, who are costing us taxpayer dollars, who are no longer a threat to society. You're going to hear about that today. You're going to hear about early release. You're going to hear about a myriad of things that we believe as a collective puts our criminal justice system in line with being just and being corrective and not just being punitive. So please pay attention to what you're going to hear today and begin to call your state senators and your state representatives and let them know that they should be supporting this package of legislation to make our criminal justice system a just system. And with that, we turn over to Chairman Tim Briggs.
Thanks, Jordan, and thanks, Chair Kinsey, for organizing today. I want to acknowledge a couple legislators that walked in since the beginning. Representatives Burgos, Guzman, and Sims have joined us, so thank you for that. I'm happy to be here as the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee and lend my support to this important package of bills. I constantly say we need a smart on crime approach to our justice system. This package of bills provides us an opportunity to do better and be smart about it. Who would oppose a bill to provide a veteran with a pre-release briefing so that the veteran knows what benefits they are qualified for upon release? Who would want to deprive a person an opportunity to see their family and develop relationships with their children? Who could want a senior citizen or terminally ill person to die in a state prison when we know it will cost the taxpayers millions of dollars? I ask these questions rhetorically, but I know the answer. The people who would oppose these common sense bills are people driven by vengeance, fear, revenge, retribution, and punishment. How about we consider forgiveness, mercy, compassion, fairness, righteous, prudent, and smart? These are the words that come to mind when I think of these bills. Viewing the justice system through terms like these will result in lower recidivism rates, safer streets, and substantial savings. Fundamentally, I believe we should treat people in a humane way. Punishment without rehabilitation doesn't work. People are worth saving, and our communities are better off when we invest in them, and we show each other mercy and compassion. For these reasons, as chair on the Democratic side, I say I'm ready to do my part to advance this package of bills. And with that, I'd like to introduce Senator Sharif Street.
Thank you. Thank you, Leader McClinton, Whip Harris, Chairman Briggs, Representative Kinsey, and others who have joined us today. A few things. I want to talk to you today about geriatric or medical parole. It is important for some basic reasons. The risk of recidivism for people who have been deemed geriatric is lower than the general society, and in many cases is at 1%, or there's no real risk at all. The cost of incarceration for geriatric individuals can be up to over $100,000, which is about 2.5 times more costly than other people. Resources which could be used in many cases, to fund things we need in society, victim services, reentry programs, and could be through justice reinvestment used to reduce our crime and make people safer. It is common sense that we move forward geriatric parole, and there is a moral element. When people have reached a point in life where they are geriatric, when people have reached a point in life where they are medically no longer sound, it is the humane thing to provide an opportunity for them to reunite with their families. And in many cases, they can have an effect of making, of going back in those communities, sharing their experiences, and reducing the likelihood that others will become incarcerated. Ultimately, it is our responsibility to make people safer, and it is our responsibility to be good stewards of the taxpayer dollars. Passing geriatric parole, medical parole, makes good moral and fiscal sense. And I urge you to urge your my colleagues in the Senate and the House to move forward. I want to note, I believe Representative Burgos and Representative Kinsey have offered similar legislation in the House. I don't care whether it passes the House or the Senate first. We need to get this legislation to the governor's desk. Please urge members of the House and Senate to pass it. Thank you so much.
Next, you will hear from Representatives Schusterman, Kim, and Hohenstein.
Thank you all for being here to discuss this important issue. This issue affects our future community members. Rep. Kinsey's resolution would require the Joint State Government Commission to study SCI's nutritional value of food and incarcerated individuals' health conditions. This legislation is about ensuring that incarcerated individuals have a basic quality of life and that they do not leave sicker than they came in. So we're talking about the food that our prisoners, the people who are incarcerated, eat every day. The reality is nutrition-based diseases are more prevalent in prison populations than in the general population. This isn't something we can ignore. Our justice system suggests that those who commit crime can serve their time and return to normal life after their sentence is served. During their sentence, which already restricts most of life's freedoms, the added punishment of poor quality of food is unnecessary and inhumane. And upon reentry into society, they do not deserve to be forever burdened with chronic health conditions such as diabetes and high blood pressure. These individuals have taken accountability for their wrongdoing, cooperated with the Department of Corrections, and already gave up years of their life to make things right in the eyes of the law. This study would aim to put a stop to the substandard conditions and ensure the health and the dignity of incarcerated individuals with the necessity of basic nutrition. Basic. It is common sense, and I thank you for listening and being here.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Patty Kim, State Representative for Dauphin County, which includes the city of Harrisburg. I, too, want to thank Representative Kinsey for his leadership and bringing us all together. So arrests are important. It's an important tool for law enforcement. However, we know that in our Commonwealth, people of color and those living in poverty are disproportionately affected by arrests and the financial burden that comes with it. In addition, every arrest also poses a physical risk both to the person being arrested and to our law enforcement officers. When it comes to low-level offenses, these are unnecessary risks to take. This legislation offers an alternative to low-level arrests where a warrant is not needed. Instead of immediately making an arrest, an officer would first need to issue a warning or a citation, asking the individual to cease their illegal activity. If the warning is ignored, then the officer can make an arrest. It's a simple first step, but it could help reduce the chances of an unnecessary and risky situation from occurring when dealing with low-level offenses. It would also save time and money for the individual, for the officer, and for the criminal justice system. we have to continue to explore alternatives to arrests and other ways to reduce incarceration rates for the sake of our constituents and for our overcrowded prisons and jails. I ask my colleagues to support this bill, co-sponsored with Steve Kinsey. Thank you very much.
I'm State Representative Joe Hohenstein, and
I represent the neighborhoods where I grew up in Frankfurt and other parts of Lower Northeast Philadelphia. I'm here to speak on the bill that would require incarcerated individuals to be permitted at least 2 in-person visits per week. I spent 25 years as an immigration lawyer, and much of that work involved visiting and representing people who were detained by the U.S. Immigration Service. As a legislator, I've also visited my constituents in prison to discuss their cases and to simply listen to them. When you visit a person in prison, you provide hope, you provide connection to the society that they are separated from. You provide a reminder that human decency and kindness do exist. A visit from friends or family is often the highlight of someone's day, week, or month when they're incarcerated. Now, if we aspire to be a fair society, we must provide humane treatment for those who are incarcerated. If we aspire to a justice system that is about restoring people, rehabilitating them to re-enter society as full and engaged citizens, we have to recognize their humanity. Our religious traditions, embodied most often in the Judeo-Christian Bible, teaches us this compassion, whether it's in the Old Testament, Hebrews 13:3, remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, or in the New Testament, Matthew 25:36, I was in prison and you came to me. Our codes, both legal and ethical, call on us to be strong enough to extend that open hand of compassion. Now, when I visited my clients, the stresses, the strains of prison life, or the legal case that we were preparing, those were constant weights on them. However, for the space of time that we could have human conversation, an interaction that gave them a feeling of some control over their own destiny, and they became less anxious, more hopeful. They were simply lighter. Expanding visitation rights gives someone a reason to do better, both inside the facility and out of it, when they come back to their family and to the rest of us. When we make incarcerated people feel more like human beings, it makes us more human as well. And I want to thank Representative Kinsey, Whip Harris, Leader McClinton, Senator Street, Chairman Briggs, all of our leadership, and my colleagues for moving these bills forward, and I'm honored to be a part of this today.
I want to acknowledge that we've been joined by Representative Webster. And next, we're going to have Representative Burgos, followed by Representative Kincaid, and then Representative Webster.
Good morning. Representative Danilo Burgos out of Philadelphia, 197th Legislative District. Today, I'm here to discuss how we can take care of those incarcerated who are aging, grant them medical parole, and early release. While these individuals have committed crimes at some point in their life, they still deserve to be treated with dignity and as persons that deserves, especially the age, we must make sure their needs are met. Aging is a process that takes a toll on human being. And for those living in the conditions of a prison, it can even be more damaging. Pennsylvania's prison population over the age of 50 to 55 has increased from 6% in 1996 to 22% in 2019. These older inmates are more likely than members of the general population to suffer from cardiac disease, high blood pressure, hepatitis C, diabetes, and other potentially debilitating chronic ailments. These ailments also put them at COVID risk. This is why we must allow for elderly nonviolent inmates to have medically debilitating or terminal ailments a medical parole. Along with this, we will create a medical parole program for inmates who are 60 years of age or older and who have a terminal illness. Are these inmates dangerous? No. According to a study from the ACLU, most older inmates are incarcerated for nonviolent crimes. So we would not be releasing dangerous criminals back onto our streets. These inmates deserve to get medical treatment that they need and reconnect with our communities towards the end of their lives. The lack of empathy in our society today is tearing this country apart and our state. We must show that we just don't believe in Jesus Christ on Sundays, but every day of the week. Nuestra comunidad, nuestros miembros de nuestra comunidad que están encarcelados de la tercera edad, le debemos demostrar empatía y tratarlo como seres humanos. Thank you, Chairman Kinsey, and my colleagues, and Representative Brooks, thank you for joining us.
Thank you all for being here today, and thank you to my colleagues. This is such an important topic to be talking about. We have to look to the past. We have to look to history when we are talking about our criminal justice system, because we need to understand why it is that our criminal justice system is set up the way that it is. We established certain rights in our Bill of Rights because we acknowledged the intolerable cruelty of the British Empire that they visited on us when we had the audacity as colonists to stand up against them. The living conditions of prisons and poorhouses were just unconscionable. And so we established rights for defendants. There's a reason that the only parties that are in our Constitution that are protected are defendants. And it's because those are the only people whose liberty rights are at stake when you have an interaction with the state. And we acknowledged as a nation that people have a fundamental right to be treated as humans in our criminal justice system. And I think to an extent there's been a loss of acknowledgement that that was really the purpose of protecting people's rights, was to ensure that humanity was protected, that human dignity was protected even when you did something wrong. Because that reflected more on us as a society than it did on the person who committed the crime. So when we are talking about medical release, what we're really talking about is compassionate release, is acknowledging the humanity of the people who have served time in prison and are facing down death in prison, not because they are being put to death, but because they are aging into a place where they will die separate from their families, they have developed a disease that will kill them, and they deserve the right to say goodbye to their family, to their communities out in the world. And we fundamentally established our justice system to acknowledge that people have a right to be human and be treated as human. And so a compassionate release statute that actually works, because we have 52 different versions of compassionate release, and the one thing that they have in common all across our country is that we don't use them nearly enough. And this legislation, this package of legislation, will allow us to actually treat people with human dignity and to see people return to their communities, at least to just say goodbye one last time. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here. I'm Joe Webster, and I represent the 150th House District in Montgomery County. I want to add my thanks, special thanks, to Representative Kinsey for having us here today and hope, in a summary of fashion, that for all those watching these proceedings, recording them in one way or another, that you begin to recognize the scope of effort behind compassion and criminal justice reform. This is just one more way that we make Pennsylvania just a little better than it is today. And I'm going to talk about extending that to veterans in our prison systems who are incarcerated there and who have served their country. So House Bill 1661 is simple and powerful. It provides that our veterans upon release would receive a briefing that tells them about their military and veterans benefits that are available to them as they move back into society. And these are federal benefits and state benefits here in Pennsylvania, and teach them how to apply for what they're entitled to. It may not surprise you, but in the numbers, in the United States of America, as many as 180,000 veterans are incarcerated. 5,000 of those are in Pennsylvania, approximately. These are men and women who have served our country, men and women who may have unique or extensive medical, mental health, or substance use disorder needs that are militarily related, that are part of their service to our country. So I strongly believe, and I don't think this should surprise anyone, that these men and women deserve just a little bit more consideration in that regard. So you've heard my colleagues note that reentering society is challenging for everyone who's been incarcerated. And we know study after study that a little help, that any connection to the norms of society, whether it be family and friends, education or a job, voting rights, when a person is able to connect to our community, it reduces recidivism and it creates a path forward for that person. Well, simply, and in this case, the veterans in our prisons, we may have a connection for them if we just use it to give them access to their own military rights, privileges, and benefits. So I shouldn't have to say this, but in conclusion, it's important every time I get to speak about our veterans community. The United States overall, we don't do enough for our veterans. We just simply don't. In this case, no matter what the circumstances and reasons that a veteran might be serving time in prison, we should also be aware that they have served our country. And we purport to honor that service. Let's really do it in one small way, a service that we honor. And I think House Bill 1661 is a small step in that direction of restoring their honor. Thank you.
I want to acknowledge the presence of Representative Madden. And before we conclude, I'm going to ask Mr. Anton Andrews to join us. He's with the Prison Society to give a few remarks.
Good morning. My name is Anton Andrew, and I'm here on behalf of the Pennsylvania Prison Society. First, I'd like to thank Representative Kinsey and everyone gathered on this stage, because Pennsylvania's more than 62,000 adults who are presently incarcerated are among our most invisible, our most neglected, and our most traumatized individuals. And for that reason, and that reason alone, the Pennsylvania Prison Society, since 1787, when Benjamin Franklin and Benjamin Rush saw the conditions at our first state prison, has been working to make sure that everyone in custody has a safe and humane experience. So I just want to thank everybody here for recognizing the basic proposition that every one of us, regardless of commission of a crime, regardless of past mistakes, regardless of poverty, is entitled to dignity. Thank you very much for having me, and Representative Kinsey.
Folks, there are 7 pieces of legislation that we're proposing. This is not a Democratic nor a Republican issue. It's a people issue. And I want to definitely thank all of my colleagues who were able to join me this morning. And as we look at these 7 pieces of legislation, I'd be remiss if I did not recognize the fact that out of the 7 pieces of legislation, there were 4 pieces of it that had bipartisan support. And with that, I want to also thank Representative Brooks, who joined us this morning. Representative Brooks, I want to thank you. You know, some folks simply say, well, they're all Democrats. No, the reality of it is that this is a bipartisan effort. And Representative Brooks here, sort of his presence here sort of justifies the fact that it is bipartisan. And as I mentioned, out of the 7 pieces of legislation that's being proposed, there are 4 pieces of it that have support from our colleagues on the other side of the aisle. I want to thank our partners, because again, this is not just simply written up by members here. This is actually in conjunction with support and advocacy groups, many that could not be here with us this morning, but they lend their support, their efforts, their knowledge to help us craft these pieces of legislation. And let me be clear. Every piece of legislation that comes out of the Pennsylvania House, whether it's from the House or the Senate, is just legislation that we believe can make our society better. And that's what we're working towards. With that being said, I'm going to ask my colleagues to move forward. We're going to take any questions. And again, I want to make sure that I thank my members who are here, our advocacy groups, the staff, judiciary committee that helped us to put this together. So if my members can just move forward, and we'll just take any questions that might be asked, if there are any questions. Yes?
On the geriatric bills, would those include inmates who are serving life sentences?
There's 2 bills that are related to geriatric in a sense. One is the terminally ill, and the other is the aging out. And I believe out of the 2 bills, one of them will involve individuals who are serving life sentences, and that's for the folks who are terminally ill. Terminally ill, we're talking about individuals who are literally on their deathbed. So that one will include individuals who might be serving a life sentence.
But wouldn't that effectively end life sentences?
I'm sorry?
Wouldn't that effectively get rid of life sentences? I mean, isn't the whole point of life sentences you die behind bars?
Well, let me say this. There are certain procedures that would have to be followed, and we're going to work with the Department of Corrections to do that. So as I stand here before you and tell you that as proposed legislation, we are still working with the administration to definitely finite what the actual standards will be in regards to those individuals who could be possibly released under that piece of legislation.
I think the other aspect of that is that study after study has shown that life sentences don't have an actual impact. There are diminishing returns for incarcerating people until they die. And in fact, if you talk to a lot of people who work in the Department of Corrections, whether it's corrections officers or the administration, they will tell you the people that they feel safest around in prison are the people who are there for life. Because they are, by and large, they have aged out of the criminality that got them there in the first place, and they are trying to be good members of the society that they are in. So if this has the effect of ending life sentences, I'm okay with that.
Yeah, great. Any other comments, members? Okay, great. Are there any other questions?
Great. We want to say thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you very much to the members also.
Thank you. Awesome.
Just today. And then maybe just like talking.